the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit.
Amen.
You may be seated. Sunday evening during my first year in seminary was a fun time. I was one of the few people in the dormitory who had cable, so about 10 of us would gather in my room to watch Ernest Angley, the great tele-evangelist, coming live on Channel 50 from Cuyahoga, Ohio. If you've never seen him, he has an ill-fitting toupee, a rather portly man, and one full of drama. We would sit there and watch him heal people. It was hilarious for us when someone came up and they were deaf and he put his fingers in their ears and he'd say, "Baby," and they'd respond, "Baby." And then people would come up with some kind of emotional distress, and of course he'd touch them on the forehead and back, they would fall at the waiting arms of attendants behind them. It was really funny when people came up with crutches. Quite obviously, they were new crutches, and so he would take them from the person, and the person would stand there wobbling, and Ernest would lay his hands upon them, and behold, the next thing, the person would throw the crutches away and walk and be able to go back to their seat. Now, of course, you have to appreciate the fact that our humor was beer-filled. We were, after all, good Lutherans. I didn't take all of this too seriously until I had a course in the Acts of the Apostles later that year and came to look at the authentic marks of the early church. One of the surest marks of the authenticity of the church was and continues to be healing. We have an example of this, of course, in our gospel lesson for today. Jesus is at a pool called Bethesda in English. It is a pool which is still there. It was excavated in the 1800s. It's a two-level pool, one of which has free-flowing water in it. If, in fact, there was water in it, it would flow into the next pool, and that pool had steps leading down into it. It's thought that it might have been a mikvah, which is a traditional Jewish bath for cleansing ritually of sin. In any case, this was a pool that was very popular with people because at some time during the day, the spirit would come down upon the waters and they would be troubled. That is to say that there would be ripples on the water. And the first person who was able to get into the troubled water, according to tradition, would be healed of whatever malady that he or she had. So Jesus comes to the scene, and of course that's the origin of wade in the water, God's going to trouble the water. God's going to fill the water with his spirit. Jesus comes upon a man who's been there for 38 years. And he tells Jesus that he has never been able to get into the water because as he makes his way down to the water, somebody invariably knocks him out of the way. Now, Jesus seems a little impatient with this man, and maybe we should be also. You realize that 7 days a week for 38 years is almost 14,000 attempts to get into the water. If you exclude Sundays, when healings probably wouldn't take place, it's almost 12,000 opportunities to be healed. Now, surely this man could have made an agreement with the people around him that after being there so long that he could be the first in. Or why didn't he come and sit at the edge of the pool? And when the waters were troubled, just rolled himself right into the water so that he would be healed of his paralysis. And Jesus asks him a very pointed question, "Do you want to be healed? Do you want to be healed?" It's almost to say, "Why haven't you been healed?" It's an interesting question. We all know people for whom being sick is something that they revel in. Maybe that's what Jesus sees in this particular man. We really don't know. But Jesus offers him healing, as he has done for so many other people in our gospel accounts. He says to the man, "Take up your mat and walk." And miraculously, without even going into the troubled waters, the man rolls up his mat, and he stands up, and he is able to walk, and he goes off. It's unfortunate that the pericope for today doesn't continue because there's an interesting exchange between this man, now healed, and the Pharisees, who want to know why he's carrying his mat on the Sabbath. And the man goes on to explain that someone healed him, and he doesn't know who it is. And then later, he finds Jesus again in the temple quarters, and he says to Jesus that, "You're the one who healed me," and he recognizes in Jesus the authentic dwelling of God's Holy Spirit, because it was only through the Holy Spirit that this man was able to receive healing. Today the question is asked of each one of us, do we want to be healed? First of all, we have to recognize that we have things of which we should be healed. Healing can come in a variety of ways. People can come forward with physical maladies. Others come forward with emotional difficulties, which separate them from God and from one another. And still other people come with problems of the spirit, the thing which makes them believe that God is not present for them and that God is not real, working in and through their lives. Now, to explain why some people are healed and other people are not is beyond the scope of this sermon this morning, but it is certainly a topic of another sermon. But when we believe that Jesus is present, and when we believe that healing is something that can happen, then I think we approach it with greater expectations. When my friends and I sat in front of the television so many years ago and watched Ernest do his healing, we had no expectation that healing was going to be offered to these people. We thought that it was all a farce, and we found it to be funny. And of course, what we were doing was grieving the Holy Spirit, which in fact has the power to heal. We're told in the book of James that whenever anyone is sick, he should call the elders of the church to come and pray over him. The elders will hear the confession of the sick person, anoint that sick person with oil, lay hands upon him, and the prayer and these actions will, and I say will, make the sick person well. There is every expectation that something amazing is going to happen, and if you don't believe it's going to happen, well, maybe that is an impediment for the working of the Holy Spirit in you. And curiously enough, in our second lesson for today, we discover the true source of healing. John the seer writes in Revelation about the coming end time. Revelation is a very difficult book. If you've ever tried to plow through it, I imagine that you probably stop somewhere midway through it, because it talks about the plagues inflicted on mankind, the plagues that are contained in bowls, the angels that inflict these things on human beings, the four horsemen. It's very difficult to understand. The last few chapters are the happy part of Revelation, because what they talk about is the restoration of Jerusalem, the rebuilding and renewing of God's own kingdom. And John, in a vision, high on a mountain, sees the new Jerusalem come down. It's an amazing place because there's no wall around it. It doesn't need a wall. The portals to the city stand wide open, and they're made of great, large pearls, each of them. And there's no temple in the city because God will dwell with his own people, and there's no need for a temple or a church in which to worship because God is everywhere. There's no sun or moon to lighten or darken this place because God's presence is the light. But the most appealing thing for us today as we think about healing is that there is a throne, and on the throne is the Lamb that was slain for us. And from the throne comes water abundant. Now, these are people for whom water can be a very deadly thing because it carries so many diseases, bacteria and things like that. But here, this river, you can drink abundantly from it, and it will not hurt you. And growing on the side of the river are the trees of life. Now, you may think that it was the tree of the knowledge of good and evil that got mankind into such difficulty in there in the Garden of Eden, but it really wasn't. Once they had their minds open to know good and evil, then they looked to the tree next to that tree. And it was, of course, the tree of life. Eating that fruit would convey upon these first two people the gift of eternal life. And God wasn't happy that they knew good and evil, but he certainly wouldn't have been happy if they now lived forever and were very much like him, So he barred their way to the tree by throwing them out of the Garden of Eden. But now, in the restored Jerusalem, the tree of life is in abundance. It lines this heavenly river. And we're told that it bears fruit 12 times a year, which means that it's always in fruit. And you can eat it abundantly, and you will live forever. And as we're going to sing in our hymn of the day, the leaves of that tree are there for the healing of the nations. God, in the death and resurrection of our Lord Jesus Christ, bridges the great chasm between us and God, one which we could not possibly get through. The cross is laid across it, and we are then connected once again to God through this miracle. And if that isn't healing, I don't know what is. It is the great healing of the nations, the healing of us as individuals, the healing of God's people, the healing of the world. And if we don't expect that it's going to happen, we need only look through the pages of Scripture and find that healing is a mark of the church. And if you're part of the church, you need to continue to believe that God offers you healing. Believe it or not, Ernest is still at it. He's 94 years old. I don't think he's on television anymore. Maybe he needs healing himself. But in any case, his life was spent in the quest of offering people the healing touch. And so you also are called to expect it in your lives, but you are called also to give it to other people. The healing hands of Christ come through us for a world that needs hope. The healing touch comes to other people through us because we recognize that Christ has died, he is risen, and he will come again. Amen.
Amen. Amen. believe in one God,
Father the Almighty, maker of heaven and earth, of all that is seen and unseen. We believe in one Lord, Jesus Christ, the only Son of God, eternally begotten of the Father, God from God, light from light, true God from true God, begotten, not made, of one being with the Father. Through him all things were made. For us and for our salvation, he came down from heaven. By the power of the Holy Spirit, he became incarnate from the Virgin Mary and was made man. For our sake, he was crucified under Pontius Pilate. He suffered death and was buried. On the third day, he rose again, in accordance with the Scriptures. He ascended into heaven and is seated at the right hand of the Father. He will come again in glory to judge the living and the dead, and his kingdom will have no end. We believe in the Holy Spirit, the Lord, the giver of life, who proceeds from the Father and the Son. With the Father and the Son, he is worshipped and glorified. He has spoken through the prophets. We believe in one holy, Catholic, and apostolic church. We acknowledge one baptism for the forgiveness of sins. We look for the resurrection of the dead and the life of the world to come. Amen.
Prayers of the people. Please stand and we ask you to pray. Let us join through prayer with everything that lives. Let us acknowledge to God the one life we share, saying, O God, who makes us one, hear our prayer. O God, your Holy Spirit is alive in all the earth. Your Spirit has moved and shaped land and sea. Trees and beasts still moves and shapes us into creation. Through Christ, we know your one Holy Spirit, for you are God of all. That all the world may know your Spirit, we pray. O God, who makes us one,
hear our prayer.
Open your world before our eyes so that we see far and near. Show us newly what lives around us, over and beyond and within. Give us the mind of Christ. O God, who makes us one,
hear our prayer.
Bring us to one another that we may hear and understand each other. Bring trust and sympathy between the peoples of the world. Make all nations one household with many rooms. O God, who makes us one,
hear our prayer.
Heal us who are sick, especially those on our parish prayer list, and others we name now, either silently or aloud. Cheer us who are guilty. Love us who are alone. Join us who are distant. Call all the world to yourself. O God, who makes us one,
hear our prayer.
Enliven the church with the Spirit of Christ. Through us, give your loving Spirit to the world in need of comfort. Make our many gifts one offering to the world. O God, who makes us one,
hear our prayer.
O God, keep our minds inside your love, for we are many parts and need to be one. We beg for this unity which only your Spirit can give, through Christ our Lord.
Amen.
The peace of the Lord be always with you.
And also with you.
Yeah.
morning. Please be seated. Good morning, and welcome home to the Churches of the Nativity and Holy Comforter. We're delighted to see you on this rainy day. We're glad to be washing away pollen and watering our yards, so we thank God for healing rains. Welcome to this table, which is God's table, where we're all fed and where you brought food to feed others. Thank you for your gifts to the CARES Food Pantry. Every first Sunday of the month is what we normally do, and I usually call down there and ask them what they need, and this week was jelly and rice and pasta, but whatever you brought will be put to good use, so thank you for caring for others. It is what we strive to do here. In a couple of weeks, May 10th, a Tuesday, we're taking a bus trip to the National Cathedral. Some of us are having tea, but all those tickets are sold, but there's still room on the bus if you want to take the ride with us and then walk around the cathedral close and then come back with us. Tickets are $25. You can call the office May 10th, it's a Tuesday. And then May 15th is going to be fun here, 2 weeks.
May 15th, we're having a baptism once again. And of course, it's the day we recall the coming of the Holy Spirit. Afterwards, we're having a chili cook-off. The best chili wins a all-expense-paid trip to the Holy Land.
Yes!
Could you believe it? Could you believe
it? April Fools, yeah.
We hope that you'll bring some chili and help us celebrate the fire of the Holy Spirit with a little spice in our lives. Okay.
Yes, thank you. So we'll have a little contest. We'll come up with some prize. It'll be some prize. I'm not sure what. Pay attention to other ways you can help others. Our Seafarers Ministry and Reading Camp is coming up. And then June the 11th is our big fair, our June fair. We think it's the 90th legendary June fair of the Church of the Nativity. But we have some good Lutheran volunteers who joined us for our meeting this morning, so thank you. There's a bake sale, so if you have other things besides chili you want to bake to sell, we take things for our flea market, not clothes, not big 45-inch TVs that we can't get rid of, but other things, toys, kitchen items, whatever you need to clean your closet out. We sell all those things, hopefully books as well, and kids' activities, so stay tuned for more of that and be cleaning out your closets, all to benefit the ministries that we do here. Anything else? Book club coming up as well. Does anybody have a birthday or anniversary coming up? Yes, you do. Gracious God, we thank you for these, your servants, and for the anniversaries of their retirements and births and anniversaries. We pray that you would continue to shower upon them your blessings and your good health, your grace, and your abundance of love. Bless them in the name of the Father, the Son, and the Holy Spirit this day and forevermore. Amen.
Amen.
Now walk in. Oh, and there's also food after this, so join us upstairs for refreshments to say. Walk in love as Christ loved us and gave himself for us an offering and sacrifice to God.
Thank you.
Lord be with you.
And also with you.
Lift up your hearts.
We lift them up to the Lord.
Let us give thanks to the Lord our God.
It is right to give our thanks and praise.
It is indeed right, our duty and our joy, that we should at all times and in all places give thanks and praise to you, almighty and merciful God, for the glorious resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ, the true Paschal Lamb who gave